Recorded Books and RB Digital present Analogia, The Emergence of Technology Beyond Programmable Control by George Dyson. Narrated by Donald Corren. Chapter 0. The Leibniz Archipelago. From Analog to Digital and Back. In July 1716, Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz, a 70-year-old lawyer, philosopher, and mathematician whose tragedy was that he met the lawyers before the scientists, joined Peter the Great, the 44-year-old Tsar of Russia, in taking the cure at Bad Pyrmont in Saxony, drinking mineral water instead of alcohol for the duration of their 8-day stay. Leibniz, who would be dead within the year, laid 3 grand projects before the Tsar. First was a proposal to send an overland expedition across Siberia to the Kamchatka Peninsula and the Pacific, where one or more ocean-going vessels would be launched on a voyage of discovery to determine whether Asia and America were separated and, if so, where. What languages were spoken by the inhabitants, and could this shed light on the origins and evolution of the human race? Were the rivers navigable? How does the magnetic declination vary with location, and does it also vary in time? What lay between the Russian Far East and the American Northwest? Could Russia extend its claims? Second was a proposal to establish a Russian Academy of Sciences, modeled on the success of the existing European academies while leaving their infirmities behind. Third was a plan to use digital computers to work out, by an infallible calculus, the doctrines most useful for life, that is, those of morality and metaphysics, by encoding natural language and its underlying concepts through a numerical mapping to an alphabet of primes. Leibniz sought Peter's support to introduce this calculus ratiocinator to China, whose philosophers he credited with the invention of binary arithmetic, and to adopt this system in the Tsar's campaign for the modernization and expansion of Russia, which Leibniz saw as a tabula rasa, or blank slate, upon which his vision of a rational society based on science, logic, and machine intelligence might play out. The human race will have a new kind of instrument, which will increase the power of the mind much more than optical lenses strengthen the eyes, he argued. Reason will be right beyond all doubt only when it is everywhere as clear and certain as only arithmetic has been until now. Leibniz observed that the functions of binary arithmetic correspond to the logical operations of and, or, and not. Strings of binary symbols, whether represented by zeros and ones or black and white marbles, could both encode and logically manipulate concepts of arbitrary complexity in unambiguous terms. This universal language would open a new era in human affairs. Leibniz saw Peter's ambitions as the means to propagate this revolution, drawing the analogy that building a new structure is easier than remodeling an old one whose foundations have settled unevenly, leaving defects that have to be repaired. The Russian Academy of Sciences was founded in 1724. The Great Northern Expedition was launched in 1725, followed by a 126-year Russian presence in America, beginning with the arrival of Bering and Chirikov in 1741, and ending in 1867 with the transfer of Alaska to the United States. Leibniz's third project received no support. Although so amused that he had looked at the instrument for half an hour and even probed it with a pencil to see how it worked, Peter took no further interest in Leibniz's mechanical computer. The powers of digital computing were lost on the Tsar. It took another 2 centuries and the invention of electronics for Russia, China, and the rest of the world to become the tabula rasa of Leibniz's plan. Then, suddenly, in less than 50 years, we advanced from the first primitive electronic digital computers, assembled from vacuum tubes and exchanging coded sequences at the speed of punched cards and paper tape, to a world where code proliferates at the speed of light. The ability of digital computers to mirror the non-digital universe is taken for granted today. To question the supremacy of these powers elicits the same disbelief as trying to explain them did in the time of Peter the Great. The differences between analog computing and digital computing are fundamental but not absolute. Analog computation deals with continuous functions whose values change smoothly over time. Digital computation deals with discrete functions whose values change in precise increments from one instant to the next. Leibniz might have envisioned an analog computer operating by means of a fluid running through a maze of pipes, regulated by valves that could be varied continuously between fully open and fully closed. As one of the founders of the infinitesimal calculus, he was no stranger to the continuous functions that such a device could evaluate or control. Instead, he envisioned a digital computer, with binary arithmetic executed by marbles shifted by on-off gates as they ran along multiple tracks. These marbles were either black or white, no shades of gray allowed. They could not be divided into smaller marbles or merged into marbles of larger size. When arriving at a gate, they had to follow either one path or the other, with no middle ground. Any given sequence of marbles either corresponded exactly to some other sequence or did not. All questions had to be stated unambiguously, and if a question was repeated, the answer would be the same every time. This imagined computer was never built, but the binary digits, or bits, that permeate every facet of our existence are Leibniz's marbles, given electronic form. Nature uses digital coding, embodied in strings of DNA, for the storage, replication, modification, and error correction of instructions conveyed from one generation to the next, but relies on analog coding and analog computing, embodied in brains and nervous systems, for real-time intelligence and control. Coded sequences of nucleotides store the instructions to grow a brain, but the brain itself does not operate like a digital computer by storing and processing digital code. If the only demerit of the digital expansion system were its greater logical complexity, nature would not, for this reason alone, have rejected it, argued John von Neumann in 1948, explaining why brains do not use digital code. In a digital computer, one thing happens at a time. In an analog computer, everything happens at once. Brains process three-dimensional maps continuously, instead of processing one-dimensional algorithms step by step. Information is pulse frequency coded, embodied in the topology of what connects where, not digitally coded by precise sequences of logical events. The nervous system of even a very simple animal contains computing paradigms that are orders of magnitude more effective than are those found in systems built by humans, argued Carver Mead, a pioneer of the digital microprocessor, urging a reinvention of analog processing in 1989. Technology will follow nature's lead in the evolution of true artificial intelligence and control. Electronics underwent two critical transitions over the past 100 years, from analog to digital, and from high-voltage, high-temperature vacuum tubes to silicon's low-voltage, low-temperature, solid state. That these transitions occurred together does not imply a necessary link. Just as digital computation was first implemented using vacuum tube components, analog computation can be implemented from the bottom up by solid-state devices produced the same way we make digital microprocessors today, or from the top down through the assembly of digital processors into analog networks that treat the flow of bits not logically, but statistically, the way a vacuum tube treats the flow of electrons, or a neuron treats the flow of pulses in a brain. Leibniz's digital universe, despite its powers, remains incomplete. Just as Isaac Newton, his rival over credit for the invention of the calculus, gave us a mathematical description of nature that predicts everything correctly, but only up to a certain point. The next revolution, will be the coalescence of programmable machines into systems beyond programmable control. There are four epochs so far in the entangled destinies of nature, human beings, and machines. In the first, pre-industrial epoch, technology was limited to the tools and structures that humans could create with their own hands. Nature remained in control. In the second, industrial epoch, machines were introduced, starting with simple machine tools that could reproduce other machines. Nature began falling under mechanical control. In the third epoch, digital codes, starting with punched cards and paper tape, began making copies of themselves. Powers of self-replication and self-reproduction that had so far been the preserve of biology were taken up by machines. Nature seemed to be relinquishing control. Late in this third epoch, the proliferation of networked devices, populated by metazoan codes, took a different turn. In the fourth epoch, so gradually that almost no one noticed, machines began taking the side of nature, and nature began taking the side of machines. Humans were still in the loop, but no longer in control. Faced with a growing sense of this loss of agency, people began to blame the algorithm, or those who controlled the algorithm, failing to realize there was no longer any identifiable algorithm at the helm. The day of the algorithm was over. The future belonged to something else. A belief that artificial intelligence can be programmed to do our bidding may turn out to be as unfounded as a belief that certain people could speak to God, or that certain other people were born as slaves. The fourth epoch is returning us to the spirit-laden landscape of the first, a world where humans coexist with technologies they no longer control or fully understand. This is where the human mind took form. We grew up as a species, surrounded by mind and intelligence everywhere we looked. Since the dawn of technology, we were on speaking terms with our tools. Intelligence in the cloud is nothing new. To adjust to life in the fourth epoch, it helps to look back to the first. The beginning of this book is set at the close of the first epoch. The ending is set at the opening of the fourth, and the second and third epochs fall in between. The following chapters illuminate these transitions from a range of viewpoints over the past 300 years. What drove the convergence of Leibniz's dreams of a digital universe with his mission to explore the American Northwest coast? How did the two movements originate, and what led them to intersect? What are the differences between analog computing and digital computing? And why does this matter to a world that appears to have left analog computation behind? To someone who grew up in the third epoch but was drawn to the ways of the first, how to reconcile the distinction, enforced by the American educational system, between those who make a living with their minds and those who make a living with their hands? In an age that celebrates the digital revolution, what about those who fought for the other side? The Bering-Chirikov expedition reached North America in 1741. The Russians, met by an indigenous population without written language but with advanced technology and arts, left a record of the Northwest coast and its inhabitants at the moment that pre-contact times came to an end. 15 members of the expedition went ashore and were left behind. Their fate remains unknown. At the close of the 19th century, the Chiricahua Apaches, descended from one-time Alaskans arriving from Asia who continued south, resisted subjugation to a later date than anyone else. In pursuit of the last of the Apaches, the U.S. government implemented the first large-scale, high-speed, all-optical digital telecommunications network in North America. The first shots in the digital revolution and the last bows and arrows deployed in war against regular soldiers of the U.S. Army were fired at the same time. The invention of the vacuum tube, or thermionic valve, enabled machines with no moving parts except electrons. Their operation limited not by the speed of sound that governs the transmission of information in mechanical devices, but by the speed of light. It was into the war surplus ferment of the electronics industry that otherwise abstract contributions from theoretical physics and mathematical logic combined to realize Leibniz's vision of binary arithmetic as a universal code. The vacuum tube, treating streams of electrons as continuous functions, was an analog device. The logical processing of discrete pulses of electrons had to be imposed upon it, against its will, until the advent of the transistor brought this age of reptiles to a close. The Hungarian physicist Leo Szilard, after helping to invent nuclear weapons, spent the rest of his life opposing them, except for their use in the exploration of space. This possibility was taken up by a privately organized, government-supported project whose mission was to reach Saturn by 1970 in a 4,000-ton spaceship carrying 100 people on a voyage modeled after that of Darwin's Beagle, allowing 4 years to complete the trip. Project Orion was abandoned by the U.S. government, while Szilard's fictional Voice of the Dolphins led to my own adventures on the Northwest coast. 3 of those years were spent in a treehouse, 95 feet up in a Douglas fir above Burrard Inlet in British Columbia, on land that had never been ceded by its rightful owners, the Tsleil-Waututh. Trees integrate a range of continuous inputs into a single channel of digital outputs, growth rings that are incremented 1 year at a time. I was surrounded by growth rings going back to the year 1426. My own version of string theory holds that lashing and sewing are overlooked drivers of our technological advance. On the Northwest coast, Russian-American colonists adopted the indigenous technology of the skin boat builders rather than replacing it with something else. I took the Russian adoption of the Aleut kayak, or baidarka, as a model, not only for my own boat building, but also for how technology is emulating the design and tactics of living organisms on all fronts. Samuel Butler's Darwin Among the Machines, appearing out of nowhere in the New Zealand wilderness of 1863, was fleshed out into his prophetic dystopian Erewhon of 1872. In his notes for Erewhon Revisited, Butler went on to warn us that the advance of artificial intelligence would be driven by advertising, and that both God and Darwin might turn out to be on the side of the machines. The optically transmitted intelligence and numbered identity tags of the 19th century campaign against the Apaches have descended to the optically fed data center recently established in the nearby desert by the National Security Agency. In the analog universe, time is a continuum. In the digital universe, time is an illusion conveyed by sequences of discrete, timeless steps. No time is there. What happens to Leibniz's vision of a digital enlightenment when all human activity is machine-readable and all steps can be retraced? In 1890, after the exile of the Chiricahua Apaches as prisoners of war to Florida, a vision received by the Paiute prophet Wovoka led to a grassroots movement among the North American First Nations, promising to bring their dead warriors and dying ways back to life. An analogous prophecy, conveyed through a mathematical conjecture known as the continuum hypothesis, suggests that the powers of analog computation, transcending the bounds of algorithms or step-by-step procedures, will supervene upon the digital and reassert control. Electrons treated digitally became bits. Bits treated statistically have become electrons. The ghost of the vacuum tube has returned. Leibniz's ideas arrived in North America twice. In the 20th century with the digital computer, and with the Bering-Chirikov expedition in the 18th. When the navigators following Peter's instructions reached the American Northwest coast, They were met by people who had been doing just fine since the last technological revolution, some 15,000 years earlier. The slate was not blank.
Chapter 1, 1741. Nikita Shumagin, Seaman's second rank, was the first to die of scurvy on August 30, 1741. He had been carried ashore in the hope that fresh air and water would save his life, but died within hours, the first of a series of fellow crewmen who died like mice as soon as their heads had topped the hatch. He was buried in a shallow grave on Nagai Island, one of a cluster of islands off the Alaska Peninsula known as the Shumagin Group today. His death left 76 men and an 11-year-old boy to make their way back to Kamchatka from America in a disintegrating 80-foot boat. Georg Wilhelm Steller, the expedition's naturalist, knew that the treeless island's abundance of low-lying vegetation could restore the crew to health, but his advice was ignored. "I asked for a few men to gather up as many anti-scorbutic plants as we would need," he complained, but the gentleman scorned even this. Steller alone gathered scurvy grass, cochlearia, lapithum, and other greens on shore, while the ship's medicine chest remained filled with the most useless medicines, almost nothing but plasters, ointments, oils, and other surgical supplies needed for 400 to 500 men with wounds from great battles, but with nothing whatever needed on a sea voyage where scurvy and asthma are the chief complaints. Steller, the sole representative of science on board the ship, was a late addition to a group of academicians who had left St. Petersburg in August 1733, attached to a voyage of discovery set in motion by Peter the Great in 1724, just months before his death. The vast undertaking, whose fate now lay in the hands of a 32-year-old botanist walking alone along a wind-swept shore, had originated with Leibniz's proposal to the Tsar. Because Russia had no Pacific fleet with which to undertake the voyage to America, it would be necessary to build one. Nothing excited the Tsar as much as building ships. If he were younger, he would have led the voyage himself. Peter had been proclaimed Tsar in 1682 at the age of 9. 3 weeks later, he had watched from the palace balcony as his maternal uncle, Ivan Narishkin, and his protector, Artamon Matveyev, were hacked to death by a pike-wielding mob. He was left with a tendency to brutality and distrust that culminated in 1718 with the torture and sentencing to death on charges of treason of Alexis, his own son. At 15, he was given an astrolabe by Franz Timmerman, a Dutch seaman attached to the royal household, and instructed in its use. At 16, at the royal estate of Izmailova on the outskirts of Moscow, he discovered a small sailing vessel left in storage and disrepair. It happened that His Majesty was in the flax yard at Izmailov and walking by the magazines where some remains of the household furniture of Nikita Ivanovich Romanov, his great uncle, were laid. The preface to the Russian naval statute of 1720 explains. He espied, among other things, a small foreign vessel, and his native curiosity not suffering him to pass it by without an inquiry, he presently asked Francis Timmerman, who then lived with him and taught him geometry and fortification, what was that. He told him it was an English boat, and that it goes with a sail, with a wind or against it, which word made him greatly wonder, and as though not credible, raised his curiosity to see a proof of it. Timmerman and a fellow shipwright, Karsten Brandt, restored the vessel and demonstrated that it could, unlike existing Russian vessels, be sailed upwind. Peter was hooked. He became obsessed with shipbuilding and seafaring, despite there being only one seaport at Arkhangelsk on the White Sea in Russia at that time. Peter supervised the construction of modern shipyards, founded the Russian Navy, and established St. Petersburg on the Baltic as the headquarters of the Russian fleet. He led training exercises, launched naval battles against the Turks and Swedes, and instituted a penalty of 5 rubles per oar for rowing on the river Neva if there was enough wind to sail. In 1697, he traveled incognito to Holland and worked as a shipwright in the East India Company yards, followed by a 3-month stay in London, where he and his entourage rented the manor house on Say's Court, owned by John Evelyn, adjacent to the King's Shipyard at Deptford on the Thames. Evelyn, who at first welcomed the Tsar's having a mind to see the building of ships, began to have second thoughts upon receiving a report that his house, featuring a private entrance to the dockyards, was full of people and right nasty. The Tsar lies next to your library and dines in the parlor next to your study. Peter was seldom at home a whole day and spent most of his time in the shipyard or out on the water, wearing commoner's dress. He's a great admirer of such blunt fellows as sailors are, Thomas Hale, an English merchant, confirmed. He invited all the nasty tars to dinner with him, where he made him so drunk that some slopped, some danced, and others fought, he amongst them. None can complain of his frolics, since he himself is always the first man. By the time Peter departed, on April 21, 1698, the damages to Evelyn's premises were so severe that Sir Christopher Wren, who had helped direct the reconstruction of London after the fire of 1666, had to be brought in to estimate the cost of repairs. Mineral water replaced brandy and vodka during Leibniz's audience with the Tsar. I spent almost 8 full days at the mineral baths in Pyrmont, attending the great Russian monarch, Leibniz reported to Johann Bernoulli, and the more I observed the character of this prince, the more I admired him. The Tsar's inclinations to experimental science, Leibniz explained, were evidenced by his drawing blood samples from all the members of his party before and after taking the cure, including the sole Russian priest among them, whose pale, thick blood was the worst of all. Peter, fascinated by medical procedures, was known to perform minor surgery, including tooth extractions, himself. After the time of drinking had ended, Leibniz continues, the prince, ingenious as he is, decided to conduct an experiment to determine the effects of the waters and had the priest's vein pierced again. The blood drawn was the purest red and of the sort you would expect in the healthiest person. I myself was there when it was brought out. The prince applauded, and not without reason, for such a remarkable change in such a short amount of time could hardly be attributed to diet alone. Leibniz was awarded a salary of 1,000 thalers a year and a secret diplomatic mission to Vienna by the Tsar. He contributed to projects ranging from the founding of the Russian Academy of Sciences to building a mechanical support for the Tsar's paralyzed arm, and appeared destined to play a growing role in Peter's court. I am to become in some way the Salon of Russia, he wrote to Sophie, the Electress of Hanover, explaining that the shortest laws, like the Ten Commandments of God and the 12 Tables of Ancient Rome, are the best. In Leibniz's philosophy, our universe had been selected from an infinity of possible universes so that the minimum number of natural laws would produce the maximum diversity of results. The instructions that launched the American expedition were Leibnizian in brevity and scope. 1. In Kamchatka or some other place, build 1 or 2 boats with decks. 2. On those boats, sail near the land which goes to the north, since no one knows where it ends, it seems is part of America. 3. Discover where it is joined to America, and go as far as some town belonging to a European power. If you encounter some European ship, ascertain from it what is the name of the nearest coast, and write it down, and go ashore personally and obtain first-hand information. Locate it on a map and return here. These orders were issued by Catherine I upon Peter's death in January 1725. No expense was to be spared. Thus, Steller, 16 years later, found himself gathering beach greens in hopes of keeping the crew alive to bring back the promised reports. The traveling academy that had left St. Petersburg 8 years earlier included the astronomer Louis de Lille de la Croyère, the botanist Johann Georg Gmelin, and the historian and ethnographer Gerhard Friedrich Müller, as well as two artists, a surgeon, an interpreter, an instrument maker, 5 surveyors, 6 scientific assistants, and 14 bodyguards, and was right luxuriously equipped. They carried an extensive library and were granted the authority to appropriate local accommodations as necessary to assist the professors in their pursuits. Le Croyer alone left St. Petersburg with 9 wagon loads of instruments, including telescopes 13 and 15 feet in length. Gmelin's party was equipped with several barrels of a particular German wine. The academic entourage occupied 12 riverboats, outfitted with cabins for the professors, on the voyage up the Lena River to Yakutsk, the limit of established navigation, where these comforts had to be left behind. The Great Northern Expedition, or Second Kamchatka Expedition, as it became better known, was the most extravagant geographic exploration ever launched. It was led by the Dane, Vitus Bering, assisted by the Russian, Alexei Chirikov, and lasted 9 years, following the first Kamchatka expedition, also led by Bering and Chirikov, which had lasted 6. More than 1,000 individuals were assigned to the second expedition, augmented by at least 2,000 exiles and other subjects recruited along the way. The burden of transporting supplies and equipment 6,000 miles across Siberia to the frontier seaport of Okhotsk was shared between animals and men. Pack horses carried 180-pound loads through the mud in summer, and human conscripts dragged sledges in winter along frozen trails. Both horses and men were worked to death. As our laborers, that is to say the deported persons, were deserting in great numbers, explained Sven Vaxel, Bering's lieutenant and father of the 11-year-old Lawrence, we sought to prevent further losses by introducing harsh discipline. We set up a gallows every 20 versts, 13 miles, along the river Lena, which had an exceptionally good effect. The expedition requisitioned 4,280 pairs of saddlebags, consumed 180,000 pounds of rye flour per year, and descended upon the local population like a plague of locusts as it made its way to the Pacific coast. The main body of the expedition took 3 years to make the trip. To proceed beyond Yakutsk, hundreds of crude riverboats were built. They were hauled up the Aldan, Maya, and Yudoma rivers by men trudging along the insect-infested, hazard-encumbered banks, spending months working their way upstream over distances that could be covered in days on the way down. A final overland leg extended through uninhabited wilderness from the headwaters of the Yudoma to the headwaters of the Yurok. We had 400 or 500 men continually on the march to and fro, Boxall reported, after transporting 600 tons of equipment and supplies over this route in 1737, the whole time harnessed to their sledges like horses, with only what the country could provide, which was rye flour and some groats. At the terminus of the Yudoma portage, a fleet of even cruder vessels was built, braving the rapids by which the Urak reached the Sea of Okhotsk, where the ships were broken up and burned for firewood if they survived the descent. The heavy freight included the ship's anchors, as well as 18 cannons weighing 738 pounds each, 10 cannons weighing 666 pounds each, and 14,400 cannonballs, all cast in central Siberia by a foundry at Kamensky, near Tobolsk, still 3,500 miles from Okhotsk. After 7 years of struggle, 2 seagoing vessels, modeled on the Dutch packet boats that had so captivated Peter during his apprenticeship, were completed at the improvised shipyard in Okhotsk. And on September 8, 1740, the voyage to Kamchatka and America began. Bering was in command of the St. Peter, and Chirikov was in command of the St. Paul. Gmelin and Müller abandoned the expedition before its departure from Kamchatka for America, while Le Croyer, who sailed with Chirikov aboard the St. Paul, failed to secure any astronomical observations, but managed to fend off the scurvy, leaving it wondered, as it was anonymously reported, that the great quantity of brandy which he swallowed every day had such a good effect. He survived the voyage, only to die upon arrival back in Kamchatka, having dressed himself in order to go ashore, and having given once more an extravagant vent to his joy at his safe return. Of the academicians, only Steller, an adjunct member of the academy recruited to the expedition in 1735 at the age of 26, accompanied by a single Cossack rifleman serving as his assistant, and unencumbered beyond his own personal effects, returned alive from America with observations, specimens, and notes. Bering was a broken man by the time the expedition left Kamchatka on June 4, 1741, rarely leaving his cabin, and deferring to Lieutenant Voxel and the fleet captain, Safron Khitrov, who supervised the operation of the ship. The St. Peter and the St. Paul became separated in a storm on June 20th and were never rejoined. Both vessels fired their cannons at intervals according to the predetermined code of signals, but after 3 days with no answer from an empty sea, they gave up and continued eastward on separate paths into the unknown. The St. Peter made landfall off Cape St. Elias at Kayak Island on July 16, 1741, dropping anchor in the lee of the island early in the morning of the 20th, when Steller, who had seen land first, was allowed to go ashore. He found campfires that were still warm, stones showing signs of having been used to sharpen copper knives, and a subterranean cache of food, including smoked salmon so cleanly and well prepared that I have never seen it as good in Kamchatka, and it was also much superior in taste. A sample was delivered to Commander Bering, who ordered that a dozen yards of green Chinese silk, 2 iron knives, an iron kettle, and 20 strings of glass beads be taken ashore and left in its place. In exchange, Steller reported, the cache was plundered to such an extent that if in the future we were to return to this place, the people would flee from us just as they did this time. Steller had only begun to explore the island when Khitrov ordered him to return to the ship. The next morning, 2 hours before daybreak, the captain commander, much against his usual practice, got up and came on deck, and without consulting anyone, gave orders to weigh anchor. Bering, who would not live to see it, set sail for home. The expedition never set foot on the American mainland. So much for the instructions left by the Tsar. 10 years the preparations for this great undertaking lasted, Steller complained, and 10 hours were devoted to the work itself. Bering left his name to an island, a sea, and a strait. Steller left his name to a sea cow, a sea lion, and a jay. Steller cultivated an adversarial relationship with the ship's officers, especially Khitrov, whose contributions to their misfortunes began at the outset with the loss of the expedition's entire consignment of ship's biscuit, being ferried to Kamchatka from Okhotsk. The Nadezhda, a shallow draft supply vessel under Khitrov's command, ran aground in leaving the harbor, an omen of things to come. A replacement cargo of biscuit had to be sent overland across the Kamchatka Peninsula by sledges during the winter, using some 5,000 dogs commandeered from the Kamchadals. 7 members of a contingent of Russians sent to secure the dogs, which their owners loved above all things, according to Voxel, were asphyxiated by flaming kindling dropped into the semi-subterranean lodgings they had expropriated from the Kamchadals. The Russians retaliated indiscriminately with grenades. The delay over the loss of the biscuits led to the expedition's wintering in Kamchatka rather than in America, as had been planned. By September, when the St. Peter stumbled upon the Shumagin Islands, the remaining biscuits were spoiled, and fresh water had run out. Steller discovered an upland spring, but Khitrov ordered the empty water casks filled from a brackish lagoon where they had landed their boats. According to Russian naval custom, critical decisions required a sea council among the ship's officers, with any dissenting opinions noted and taken into account. But the council had long ceased listening to Steller, not for being wrong, but for always believing he was right. These gentlemen want to go home, and that by the shortest road, but in the longest way, he complained as they set off with contaminated water on what he argued was the wrong course. Steller blamed Hitro for reducing their voyage of discovery from the collection of knowledge to the collection of drinking water from America at the highest possible cost. In making their way back out to sea, the St. Peter was forced to seek refuge in the lee of Bird Island, where on September 4, 1741, without expectation or search, we chanced to meet with Americans, Steller wrote. We had scarcely dropped the anchor when we heard a loud shout from the rock to the south of us, which at first, not expecting any human beings on this miserable island 20 miles away from the mainland, we held to be the roar of a sea lion. A little while later, however, we saw two small boats paddling toward our vessel from shore. The two paddlers, each in a skeletal, skin-covered kayak termed a baidarka by the Russians, approached the ship, and then began, while still paddling, simultaneously to make an uninterrupted, long speech in a loud voice of which none of our interpreters could understand a word. One of the paddlers, after painting himself from the wings of the nose across the cheeks with shiny mineral pigment, took one of a bundle of spear shafts, about 4.5 feet long, that were painted red and stowed on the aft deck of the kayak, placed two falcon wings on it, and tied them fast with whalebone, showed it to us, and then, with a laugh, threw it towards our vessel into the water. The Russians responded by placing some glass beads and two Chinese tobacco pipes on a board and tossing it into the water, the gifts being accepted and placed on the deck of the other kayak. The first paddler then became somewhat more courageous, approached still nearer to us, though with the greatest caution, tied an eviscerated entire falcon to another stick, and passed it up to our Koryak interpreter in order to receive from us a piece of Chinese silk and a mirror. The islanders beckoned the visitors to follow them ashore. Voxel, Steller, and the Kamchatal interpreter Alexei Lazukov, accompanied by 9 sailors and soldiers equipped with lances, sabers, and guns concealed under a canvas tarp, lowered the longboat and followed the kayakers, but were unable to land because of rocks and breaking waves. Lazukov and 2 of the Russians took off their clothes and waded through the surf to shore. They were received quite deferentially, as if they were very great personages, treated to whale blubber, showed where they could obtain water, and engaged for an hour in attempted conversation with their hosts. Steller and Voxel remained in the longboat, where they were visited by the apparent leader of the islanders, who had returned to his kayak, which he had lifted with one hand and carried under his arm to the water, and came paddling up to us. The emissary was made welcome with a cup of brandy, which, following our example, he emptied quickly, but also immediately spit out again. After 2 hours, with the wind rising, the landing party was recalled. But the islanders tried to persuade the visitors to stay, first with gifts, and then by holding Lazukov and attempting to pull the longboat into shore. 9 of the Americans seized him and would not let him go, Kitrov reported, which shows that they regarded him as one of their own people, even though he is a Kamchatal. The crew in the longboat then fired 2 muskets in the air, at which the islanders released the interpreter and fell to the ground, allowing the Russians to make their escape. The islanders then waved their hands to us to be off quickly, as they did not want us any longer, Steller reported. Some of them, in getting up, picked up stones and held them in their hands. This was the first recorded contact by Europeans with a people whose presence among these islands went back at least 10,000 years. 15,000 years ago, with the Pleistocene ice sheet in retreat, sea level was 100 meters lower than today. A diminished Bering Sea bordered the southern shore of Beringia, a broad, low-elevation landmass joining Asia to America that was 600 miles wide. Humans arrived in America while much of the ice sheet was still in place, either through an inland ice-free corridor or along the shoreline, or both. The coastal route now lies submerged, but growing evidence supports the kelp highway hypothesis of Knut Flodmark and Jan Erlandsson, that the first arrivals spread eastward along the edge of Beringia and then rapidly moved south. Even during the glacial maximum, there were ice-free refugia along the outer coast. Shellfish were available at low tide, shorebirds gathered by the millions, and sea mammals that hauled out on land would have been easy prey. These first Americans either left Asia as skin boat builders or became skin boat builders along the way. Once sea mammals were disassembled for food, fuel, and shelter, only a driftwood skeleton was needed to reassemble them as skin boats. At least one branch of migrants remaining in the Aleutian Islands became the Unangan, whom the Russians designated, along with some of their immediate neighbors, as Aleuts. The Aleutian Islands are treeless, not from cold, but from wind. The landscape is blanketed with chest-high grass, while the wind that prevents the growth of forests has piled the beaches high with wood. The Aleut answer to these conditions was the construction of semi-subterranean houses and semi-submersible boats. Large communal dwellings and almost unlimited marine resources supported population densities atypical of pre-agricultural times. Analogia, a settlement on what was once the end of a peninsula and is now a small island, just off Umnak Island at the eastern end of the Aleutian chain, shows a record based on the excavation of more than 2 million artifacts of continuous occupation by sea mammal hunters going back 9,800 years. In the words of the anthropologist William S. Laughlin, who began investigating the Analogia site in 1938, it was the physical and intellectual demands of open-water sea mammal hunting that led the Aleuts to shuffle a whole lot faster through the evolutionary deck. The Aleutian Islands, extending for 1,500 miles, are close enough together that it is possible to paddle from one island to the next, but far enough apart that exceptional skills were required to populate the chain. Local cultures and kayak designs could differentiate, but no one group became isolated from the rest. There was continuous competition, intermittent warfare, and cross-pollination of design. 100-mile open ocean crossings and whale hunting by solo kayakers armed with poison-tipped harpoons became routine. The Aleuts, as amphibious as the animals on which they preyed, were as integrated with their kayaks as the Apaches and Comanches would become integrated with the wild ponies they adopted as mounts. Unangan kayaks, termed Ikyach with one hatch and Uluchtach with two hatches, evidenced innovations found nowhere else. Articulated skeletons, a compound wide-tailed stern, bifurcated surface-piercing bows, and leaf-shaped paddles having complex lift-producing surfaces similar to the wing paddles developed for racing kayaks in recent years. With this, he beats alternately to the right and to the left into the water, and thereby propels his boat with great adroitness even among large waves, noted Steller after the first encounter with Aleuts. The paddler wore a waterproof jacket sewn in a continuous helix from a strip of oiled whale intestines and sealed by a secondary gasket to the hatchway around his waist. Even in very rough weather, when really high seas are running, observed Voxel, once seated in the kayak and thus fastened in it, not a drop of water can find its way inside. The St. Peter was treated less kindly by the waves. Bering's crew clawed their way westward against unrelenting headwinds, described in the otherwise matter-of-fact logbook as terrific and frightful, with seas washing over the decks. Sails and rigging began to fail. The log of the St. Peter, kept by the assistant navigator Harlam Yushin, notes that at 5 o'clock in the afternoon on September 23rd, by the will of God died of scurvy, the Grenadier Andrei Trityakov, and at 11 o'clock in the morning on the 24th, they lowered the dead body into the sea. People's minds again became as loose and unsteady as their teeth were from scurvy, Steller noted on October 2nd, and on October 10th, the rain began to turn to snow. The disease first showed itself in a feeling of heaviness and weariness in all our limbs, such that we were all the time wanting to sleep, and, having once sat down, were most reluctant to rise again, Voxel added. We became more and more depressed. The supply of vodka ran out. As long as it had lasted, it had kept the men in fairly good fettle, he notes. Deaths now became numerous, so much so that a day seldom passed without our having to throw the corpse of one of our men overboard. By October 13th, 21 men were incapacitated, and on October 19th, by the will of God, Alexei Kisilov died of scurvy, 29 men on the sick list. The next day, Nikita Kharitonov died by the will of God. And 2 days later, by the will of God, died the Marine Luka Zavyakov. We wrapped the dead Marine and dropped him into the sea. The log entries then shift to the first person, noting that, today I became very ill with the scurvy. And on the 27th, I can with difficulty stand my watch. Between November 3rd and November 4th, there were 3 deaths in 17 hours. Those still alive were giving up all hope, when at 8 o'clock in the morning on the 4th, land was sighted to the north. It is impossible to describe how great and extraordinary was the joy of everybody at this sight, notes Steller. The half-dead crawled up to see it, and little cups of brandy concealed here and there made their appearance in order to keep up the joy. In deciding whether they should keep trying to reach Avacha, the harbor they had sailed from 5 months earlier, or head for the land in front of them, which Khitrov swore could not be anything except Kamchatka, we discovered that all our big mainstays on the starboard side had parted. Nor did we have anyone able to repair the damage, says Voxel. Inspecting further, they found that the main shrouds had likewise parted on the larboard side. 49 of the crew were now incapacitated, leaving only 14 with any ability to manage the ship. Bering, who advocated pressing on for Avacha, convened a council in his cabin for a brief and one-sided discussion dominated by Voxel and Khitrov, with the lone voice of dissent beside Steller's, dismissed from the cabin by Khitrov's exclaiming, "Out! Shut up, you dog! You son of a bitch!" Determined to make for the land we had seen and by that means seek to save our lives, they approached the shore under shortened sail and attempted to anchor overnight. But another storm came up. Both main and reserve anchor cables parted, with huge waves driving the ship toward the rocks. They could do nothing more to save themselves except to enlist the help of their dead companions, who were now flung without ceremony head over heels into the sea, notes Steller, since some superstitious persons at the start of the terror considered the dead as the cause of the rising sea. With the corpses cast to the waves, the ship was swept over the reef intact, leaving them secured, with the last of their reserve anchors in 4.5 fathoms of water, as in a placid lake. November 7th dawned calm and bright. Steller, his Cossack servant Toma Lipyokhin, the 2 Voxels, Bering's clerk and expedition artist Friedrich Plenisner, and several others prepared to go ashore. They expected to find the nearest settlement, arrange for horses to transport the invalids to safety, and enlist a fresh crew to preserve the ship. "We were not yet on the beach when something struck us as strange," Steller reported. "Namely, some sea otters came from shore toward us into the sea." In Kamchatka, sea otters avoid people and are never found on land. Plenisner shot 6 ptarmigans, sending a portion of them, along with a salad collected by Steller, back to Commander Bering with Lieutenant Voxel, while Steller made the remainder into soup for the shore party, who spent the night huddled in an improvised driftwood hut. Bering, Khitrov, and most of the survivors soon moved ashore, occupying crude dugouts carved out of the sand and covered with salvaged pieces of sail. Voxel remained on board with 12 living crew members and 5 dead, battered by seas that poured into our ship over the sides. They abandoned ship on November 20th, finding life little better ashore. Our plight was so wretched that the dead had to lie for a considerable time among the living, for there was none able to drag the corpses away, wrote Voxel, nor were there those who still lived capable of moving away from the dead. Hordes of blue foxes ate the hands and feet of the corpses before we had time to bury them. Steller and Plainnessner killed 60 foxes in a single day, using the carcasses to seal the gaps in the walls of their hut. On November 23rd, the Sea Council resolved to save the St. Peter, or at least salvage its remaining contents, by bringing the ship ashore. But they could not muster enough men to raise the anchor and gave up. 5 days later, after an overnight storm, they found the ship had beached itself, better than human industry could perhaps have accomplished it, in Steller's account. There were 21 deaths in November and December, including Bering, who died miserably under the open sky on December 8th, almost eaten up by lice. Fresh food and water came too late to save his life. The captain commander lay in a little hollow in the sand, Voxel explains. The sand kept trickling down the sides and in the end had filled the hollow about half full. As the captain commander was lying in the center of the hollow, it ended by the half of his body being covered by the falling sand. Even if it had been possible to pull him out again, it would have been against his wishes, for he said to us, "The deeper in the ground I lie, the warmer I am. The part of my body that lies above ground suffers from the cold." Bering was reburied in a crude coffin where his remains rested undisturbed until exhumed in 1981 by a team of Russian archaeologists, who also recovered 7 of the St. Peter's 14 cannons, concealed under sand and gravel where the ship had come to shore. The heavy armament that had cost so many lives to transport across Siberia to Kamchatka and America had been used only for signaling and had never fired a hostile shot. Steller now flourished. Marooned on an uninhabited island, he came into his own. The 4th of 10 children, he had been trained first as a Lutheran minister, then as a physician, and finally as a botanist. Officially, he was still the expedition's mineralogist, assigned to report on any geological resources discovered in America or along the way. Because the original botanist, the designated ethnographer, the chief physician, and even the official clergyman had all abandoned the voyage, he assumed those responsibilities as well. His dietary prescriptions restored the survival.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.